Welcome to the World Cup Hall of Fame as we look back down the decades at the superstars whose portraits hang in soccer's Hall of Fame. Franz Beckenbauer, for 25 years, the inspiration behind West Germany's extraordinary World Cup record, now the only man to captain and coach his country to World Cup victory. Gary Lineker, the prolific English goalscorer, whose performances in the 1986 and 1990 finals did so much to put England back amongst the leading football nations. Eusebio, the dashing Portuguese striker, whose blistering pace and deadly shooting made him leading scorer in the 66 final. Bobby Charlton, the legendary Englishman who helped his country to a famous World Cup win in 1966. Diego Maradona, the Argentine genius, who ruled the world in 1986. Pele, the greatest player the football world has ever seen. Dino Zoff, Italy's amazing goalkeeper and the oldest man ever to lift the World Cup. And Johan Cruyff, the Dutchman, who led Holland's football revolution in the 70s. But we start with Franz Beckenbauer.
July the 8th, 1990, the Olympic Stadium in Rome. West Germany's most famous footballing son, Franz Beckenbauer, achieves an historic milestone. He becomes the first man to lift the World Cup as a manager and as a captain. West Germany, champions for the third time. For Beckenbauer, a wonderful climax to 24 years' unbroken success in the game. But far from the frenzy of Italy, Beckenbauer retreats to the mountains and the famous ski resort of Kitzbühel, where he finds the peace and tranquility to balance out his life in the fast lane. Now he reflects on a glorious World Cup career that began back in 1966.
Yeah, the first game in England, the World Cup, was against Switzerland. We beat them 5-0, and I scored 2 goals, so I was really very, very happy. And then I scored another one against Uruguay. It was in the quarterfinal. And then in the semifinal, I scored a very important goal against Russia. And Russia had the goalkeeper, Levyashin. He was probably at this time, along with Gordon Banks, the most spectacular and the best goalkeeper in the world. And I was really very, very proud to score a goal against Levyashin.
But in the final, the match went against you. Why do you think that was? Was it just home advantage, or were England that much better? What was the German point of view on that?
I think the defeat was a little bit unlucky because of the third goal. You know, all people today still talking about the goal. Was it a goal or was it not a goal? But, you know, the referee...
Was it a goal?
He gave a, from my point on, no, because, you know, I was very close. I was in the penalty area and I saw the ball bouncing right to hit the line and then bounce back. So from my view on it, it was not a goal, but it was given and it was a goal. But at the end, England was the better team and England really deserved the World Cup.
So we go on to 1970, when you had the opportunity to look for some revenge, and by then, Gerd Müller had come into the side, and it was quite a different West German side then.
Yeah, we had a little bit different from the playing side. Maybe 70 we had a better playing team, but from the personalities, players like Schnellinger, like Haller, like Schulz, Tilkowski, we missed them a little bit in Mexico, but we had a very good team. And Gerd Müller, he was sensational at this World Cup. He scored 10 goals, I think. He was the man, the striker with the most goals, and he helped us a lot to get to the semi-final.
Müller's head, Müller! Up comes Rubinho, sprint to goal! Müller the scorer, number 13, made by Libuda.
We must talk about the quarterfinal, though, because yeah, that must have been a very sweet match, having been a loser in 1966.
I think England 70 was better than 66. It played an excellent performance till it comes to our game. And the first hour, 60 minutes, we really get destroyed. You know, we have been 2-0 down, England lead 2-0. And we didn't have one chance to get one goal or to get an equalizer or whatever. And then after 1 hour, the game turns completely. I don't know why. Maybe it was too easy for England and they reduce, you know, the speed or whatever, and lost a little bit the concentration. But then after 1 hour, we started to play.
This goal. Ooh, and Moore stopped that one in the stomach and it hurt. Over on. Beckenbauer. Moore still down injured. Beckenbauer! In the net! Beckenbauer scores! So that cuts it back a bit. Law now. For Germany. Great appeal by Ackball. It won't be given. Stelling at number three. There's Sailor. Here's Grabowski again, the crowd beginning to rise to the West Germans. Grabowski trying to tantalize Cooper. A good cross ball. Law on the far post. And then Fuller. Fuller has done it. Georgi Muller. Give that man just a fraction of a chance that Georgi Muller does it.
But after beating England, the West Germans go out in the semi-finals after a great battle with Italy. 4 years later, the World Cup switches to West Germany. Beckenbauer leads the team. Being host nation and favourites to win is added pressure for the Germans. There's unrest in the camp. Preparations don't go smoothly.
After our three games in the group, we played really very, very bad. And then we had a big disaster, a big confrontation, the players, the coaches, everything. And that clears a little bit. I blamed Uli Hoeneß, because Uli Hoeneß, he was a young star at this time, a lot of abilities and a lot of talents. But he was playing more or less for himself. And it was, you know, in a national team, there's no one allowed to play for himself, because it's still a teamwork, and particularly in a national team. And so it clears a little bit, the situation, and the thunderstorm sometimes, you know, clear the weather situation. It was exactly this.
And one or two of the managers of the last 16 clubs who've seen Poland in these finals here have said that they've faded quite a bit in the last 30 minutes of every game. Well, we're in the last 15 minutes of this one as Bonhoff goes forward. Muller now with a chance. Yes! And Muller doesn't miss those. And Schön loves that one. The Bayern bomber does it.
Gerd Muller's 56th goal in 70 appearances for his country earns West Germany a place in the final. Now they play Holland for the Jules Rimet trophy in Munich. The Dutch in magnificent form, playing total football.
I can understand the people who prefer to Holland to win the World Cup, because Holland started on the top. From the first game on, they played every game world-class standard. We not. We started very poorly. We started from the bottom. And then game after game, we played. And then in the final, we had the same standard. And maybe it was the lead of the Dutch team maybe was too early. You know, we even didn't touch the ball. You know, the kickoff, Holland had the ball. You know, they made the kickoff, and then they played 1 minute, and then penalty. 1-0 against us.
Holzen by. Crowd. West Germans roaring him into the box. Holzenbein going all the way on his own and fell most dramatically, and the penalty given. So, two penalties in the game. Muller was going to take the penalties for the West Germans when Hoeneß missed against Poland, but it's Breitner, the man who tucked one away against Scotland, who is going to take this penalty. This one for 1-1. He got it. And the ground erupts. As in on my watch for 26 minutes. West Germany back in the game. Good running by Bonhoff. Muller there to support him. Going on his own. Now Muller looks for it. Gets it. Oh, that's the way that little man gets them.
And also I was very ambition to, you know, to be the first captain to hold the new statue, because it was a new one. You know, the old cup was by Brazil, yeah. Because they won three times, and then the cup is now in Brazil.
There's the presentation then. There's the World Cup 74. There's the skipper whose side has won it, Franz Beckenbauer, record cap holder.
If you're able to win the World Cup and to be also the captain of this team, I think that must be the highlight. Yeah, it was the highlight of my career. Yeah.
So, after a long and distinguished career as a player, how did Franz Beckenbauer react to the offer from the West German Federation to manage his country?
I get the shock because I never wanted to be a manager. I never wanted to be a coach. I was 1 year, or I would say 6 months, out of playing. I finished in Germany 82 in Hamburg. Then 83, I went to Cosmos again to help them to do something for soccer in the United States. And then at the end of 83, I stopped my career completely. And 6 months later, the federation asked me to take over the responsibility of the German national team. And then I said, okay, I help you. But not a long time. I help you maybe 1 year, maybe 2 years. I don't know how long does it take to get the situation quiet, to bring the belief back, all from the people, from the press, from everybody.
The belief comes flooding back. 1986, West Germany reached the final once more, where they face a Maradona-inspired Argentina.
The last chair is there. Maradona, the big man's in there too. Floated to the far side. Maradona, simple little touch, but a good one to Enrique, and now Maldana, and this could be the breaker game for Argentina, and he scored! 2-0!
After 2-0 down, because, sometimes you are 2-0 down and you play offense because you have to risk everything, and then maybe do a 4 or 5-0 down. So that would be a disaster. So I was very happy after we scored 2 goals, so they had the equalizer. So then my complaint after the game, it was not a complaint. Okay, of course, it was a very stupid goal we get. The third one, there was a misunderstanding in the defense. We played offside, and Peter Briegel, he didn't get it. And so we gave the Argentinian team the opportunity to score. We lost the game 3-2. We played at the end an exciting game. We have been a very good opponent. That's it. More, I think it would be too much. If we have won the World Cup, it would be too much. For this team, it was not really a spectacular team. It was an average team. And when an average team wins the World Cup, I think it shouldn't be an example.
But Italy in 1990 is a different story. Beckenbauer believes this side's now equipped to go all the way. Players like Klinsmann, Mateus, Voller and Hassler add the flair and technique to the traditional German qualities. Their form in the early stages is stunning.
Reuter neatly in. That's a good ball to Mateus. Mateus, the captain, can try a drive. He scored! Players go to the near and far post. Klinsmann! Mateus with some space. Supporting play, Voller and Klinsmann. Mateus can go again. Oh, great goal!
Beckenbauer's men are untroubled through to the semi-finals. Now, an inspired England side stand in their way.
Bremer's there. Might try and knock it sideways. Bremer's got a marvellous curling free kick. Curled off, and in!
And Charlton shows his disgust. Can Lineker, will the bounce come for Lineker? It might come for Lineker! Yes! England are level!
So, 1-1, and that's how it stays through extra time. A place in the final will be decided on penalties. Beckenbauer looks composed. A word for England manager Bobby Robson, there's nothing they can do now. England lead 3-2 on the penalty count. Karl-Heinz Riedler for 3-3. Now it's Stuart Pearce for England. The save by Ilner. Olaf Thun for the Germans. They lead 4-3. Now, Chris Waddle to keep the match alive.
West Germany go into the final.
So Beckenbauer does it again. It'll be West Germany's sixth final appearance and a chance to join Brazil and Italy as three-time winners. The last match of Beckenbauer's World Cup career is a disappointment, marred by the feuding of the Argentines and overreactions by his own players. The trophy is decided from the penalty spot. Andy Bremer's kick ensuring that Beckenbauer bows out of World Cup football with a record that may never be broken. Two finals as a player, two as a manager, and a place in the all-time Hall of Fame. Gary Lineker has entered our Hall of Fame after outstanding performances in the World Cup finals of 1986 and 1990. Lineker's elevation to the world's biggest stage comes in Mexico and a hat-trick in England's first round match against Poland. He finishes as the tournament's top scorer with 6 goals. England's preparation begins with a period of acclimatization in the United States before the serious business of World Cup competition. In the build-up, Lineker injures his left arm. There are fears he'll play no part in the finals. Fortunately, there's no break. He's allowed to play wearing a protective bandage.
Well, I tried my best to join in the training anyway, because naturally when we got to Monterrey for the week's build-up just before the World Cup, we had to adjust a little bit to the climate because it was particularly hot. We actually trained in Colorado, and part of that training was spending some time in steam baths to sort of acclimatise to the heat. And it was stiflingly hot place, so I tried to keep myself moving as much as I could. Obviously, it was very difficult with one arm in a sling, as it was at the time. But I don't think it did me any harm missing a little bit of it anyway. I'm not the sort of player that needs a lot of training. I'm probably the other way around. I need resting a little bit between games.
But England start badly against Portugal, and Lineker isn't at his sharpest. The chances come and go just as quickly. It's the Portuguese in the end who find the deadly finish.
Garcia Mantino looking to make a breakthrough here for Portugal. And a goal, Carlos Manuel.
And there wasn't much in the way of change for the Morocco game, but obviously that didn't improve matters either. First of all, the key thing, I suppose, was Ray Wilkins going off. Did you have a good view of that particular episode?
Well, I did, and I've seen it since on the TV, of course. And it seemed very harsh. I mean, I don't think for 1 minute Ray was trying to hit the referee with the ball personally. And knowing Ray as I do, and the tremendous sportsman that he is, I'm absolutely positive he didn't. But unfortunately, that's the way the referees saw it. They're the people who are the bosses out on the pitch. And off he went. We were down to 10 men, and Brian Robson also went with his shoulder again, so we were in big trouble early on, and it just seemed that everything was going to go against us in the World Cup.
But England, with 10 men, hold on for a goalless draw. With a much-changed side, they face Poland, desperately needing an early goal.
And Beardsley and Lineker, who linked up so well together in Tbilisi. Sharp then. The third player involved is Trevor Stephen, and it's Gary Stevens. Lineker! The World Cup campaign, at last, is on the move.
I think it's probably the most important goal I've ever scored. Not probably the most spectacular goal I've ever scored, but not many of mine are anyway, but the sheer importance of it, of the fact that we had to win the game, we hadn't scored a goal in the first two, and the pressure that it took off everybody's shoulders and the fact that it came so early in the game, just, I think the goal actually probably changed my life, because without that, I wouldn't have gone on to do as well as we did in the World Cup, although obviously we didn't win it or anything. I wouldn't have been top scorer, and things could have changed. I went to Barcelona soon after, so I think it had a tremendous bearing on my life.
Beardsley. Superbly done for Hodge. Lineker is in the middle. Lineker! Brilliant!
Well, I think you'd find it hard to find a better team goal. Some of the movement and first-time passing, I remember one ball by Peter Beardsley down the line, where he didn't really look to have the angle to do that sort of pass anyway. And then Steve Hodge hit what was the perfect cross, and I managed to just get on the end of it. Although it did bounce a little bit awkwardly, I managed to keep it under the crossbar.
Fennec joining Butcher towards the near post. Mlynarczyk has misjudged it, and Lineker has a hat-trick!
With their confidence restored, it's Paraguay next and a physical game in prospect.
Well, personally, I was on the receiving end of one or two blows. I remember an off-the-ball incident where I was elbowed in the throat, which wasn't too pleasant at the time, because I could hardly breathe. But I think they get worse when they're behind, really. It's not usually a problem early on in the game. It's just, I think they just got a bit upset, which I suppose is understandable when it looked like they were going home.
Now Stevens. England trying to pick a way through and then power a way through. Hoddle and Lineker. Here's Hodge. Lineker! And here's Butcher. And Beardsley! 2-0! And here's Tottenham's Gary Stevens. And here's Lineker onside. 3-0. Argentina surely await now.
Yes, Argentina and the world's number one player, Diego Maradona, at the peak of his powers. His genius was to decide the game.
I think they're probably two of the most talked about goals in the history of football, and they both occurred in the same game. One, because of the nature of it and the fact that it shouldn't have been a goal in the first place because obviously he handballed it. And the other one because of the sheer brilliance of it, and it's certainly, I think, the best goal that's been scored in a game that I've played in. And I could tell pretty quickly that it wasn't a goal because there was a lot of people complaining it was a handball. And players know when somebody's handballed it or not. Just hard to believe that neither the referee or the linesman saw it. I don't blame Maradona.
You don't blame him?
Not for the fact that he scored a handball goal, because I think a lot of players have done it. It would have been asking an awful lot for him to go up to the referee and say, I handballed that. I don't think anybody's ever done that before, and it would have been a first. The only thing that does annoy, I think all of us really, is the fact that he's never admitted it, and to this day won't say that he actually handballed it, which sort of gets at you a little bit.
If that shouldn't have been a goal, I suppose you could argue that the other one was worth two in the sheer staggering brilliance of it.
Well, it was an incredible goal. Just a little shimmy at the start was staggering in itself, but to go on then and beat, I don't know, about three players, leaving them in the wake. I think he might have been brought down if Terry Fenwick hadn't been booked previously, but he went by him and then Terry Butcher and just flicked it in. It was an incredible piece of skill.
So, at 2-0 down, was it a case then of just going for it?
Yeah, I think we brought Chris Waddle and John Barnes on. We just went with two wingers, and then it upset them a little bit. John Barnes started going at them. Whipped one in, and I managed to pull one back. It was a great cross. And then, obviously, panic set in a little bit with them, and I nearly scored a few minutes later, and to this day I don't really know how it stayed out.
I was going to ask you that. Have you analysed it since from any
angle? Yeah, I've looked at it not a thousand times, but a lot of times. And as the cross came over, I can remember thinking, it's beat the keeper, I'm going to score. I've actually gone in, and I have actually headed it, but at the same time the defender's sort of come up from beneath me, and I think it's hit the back of his head and swerved out. And then I went on and hit the post, I think, and did my knee ligament, so I probably wouldn't have played the final anyway, if it had got there.
Was it that serious, the injury?
It probably would have kept me out for a couple of weeks, yeah.
Now we move on 4 years to Italia 90. England play all their first round games on the island of Sardinia. Once more, the team struggle to get going.
Well, I think that we never really got off to a bad start like we did in 86. I think it wasn't the perfect start, but we got a draw against Ireland. But it was never going to be an easy game. It's not against the Irish. They make life very, very difficult for the opposition. We got a lot of stick, a lot a lot of criticism on the game, which was understandable. I think it, in some quarters, and it went a bit overboard, as it often does. But we knew ourselves that a draw wasn't such a bad result, and that proved to be the case. And we actually ended up winning the group.
And in the quarterfinals, England meet the surprise team of the competition, Cameroon. Despite taking the lead through David Platt's first half goal, England are outplayed by the talented Africans. Late in the second half, they fall 2-1 behind.
Miller's up front there, the man who made us concede the penalty, and he's on again, he's put it through for a kick! Cameroon are in the lead! Now, Lineker, the hero of Mexico with his 6 goals, he finished top scorer. Only one in this campaign so far, but now we need to make it 2. Knocked in there towards Platt, but Massing got up well to make the header in. A touch in again, and that's surely a penalty! As Lineker is brought down.
I remember when the referee first blew his whistle, the relief and the thought that we were back in the game, and then until it dawned on me that I was the one expected to take it. When I must confess, a few other thoughts went through my mind. Negative thoughts on a little bit, things like, will they allow me in the country? And I even thought of my brother, who suffers more than anybody else when I'm playing. He gets himself into a terribly nervous state, and I couldn't imagine how he was. He later told me that he was cowered at the back of a room, sort of squinting through his fingers watching it. So I thought things like that. Then I thought, no, get a grip. Think about what you're going to do with it. Concentrate and don't think of anything else. And that's what I did. I just concentrated on where I was going to put it and just hoped that the goalie went the other way. And he did, thankfully.
Lineker's chance to make it 2-2. Here he goes. It is 2-2!
So did that make the second one any easier or harder?
No, it made it. The second one was easy because I knew even if I missed it, there was still a chance that we still weren't behind and we were in it. It still wasn't the most comfortable position to be in, but I'd figured, and I'd also noticed on the first penalty that he dived very early, before I kicked the ball. In the corner of my eye, I saw him. So I thought, well, if I just hit it in the middle, then he's going to dive out the way if he does the same thing, which I wasn't sure which way he'd go, but I was sure he'd go early again. So I just did that, and that's the way it worked out.
Now a semi-final against West Germany. Do the England players actually believe they can go all the way?
Well, I think we had such a tough game ahead that didn't bear thinking about concentration or anything else. We knew the Germans were a good side. They'd showed probably throughout the tournament, probably overall, to have been the best side so far. And we were just determined to put on a good performance, and we went out there, and I think we did that, particularly early on in the game, where we totally dominated them. And I think if we'd have got a goal then, I think that we'd have made it, but we didn't. And we all know what happened after that.
Bremer's there. Might try and knock it sideways. Bremer's got a marvellous curling free kick. Curled off, and in! England behind. It came off a defender, but Andy Bremer. And Charlton shows his disgust. Towards Lineker. And Lineker, will the bounce come for Lineker? It might come for Lineker. Look at the joy on the face of England's goalscorer.
Yeah, I felt confident throughout the game that we were going to do something, and when that one went in, I really, really thought we'd win. Even when it went to the penalty shootout, I thought we'd win. I was convinced in my mind. And I think after the game, I was shocked and numbed more than anything else that I really believed that we were going to play in the World Cup final. It wasn't to be, and it was certainly the saddest moment I've experienced actually playing football. Naturally, the players would always be disappointed if we didn't go all the way. But it was a tremendous experience, and it's done English football a tremendous amount of good.
Portugal's Eusebio enters the Hall of Fame following his amazing exploits in the 66 finals in England. He scores a total of 9 goals during the championships, despite being drawn in the same group as reigning champions Brazil and the much-fancied Hungarians. Portugal and Eusebio are very impressive in their opening games against Hungary and Bulgaria. Portugal score six times. But it was when Portugal played Brazil that Eusebio really begins to make an impact.
Yes, for me, yes, it's big. One this big day in my life. And the national team. Because in the first time, they played in World Cup against Brazil, and I win Brazil 3-1. And I scored two goals. It's important for me.
Oh, and given away by Danielson. And Eusebio getting some help from Simoes. Eusebio gets his shot in and it bounced awkwardly, and Manga was pleased to hold it. All the early signs here that it's going to be a difficult game for the holders of the World Cup. Well, they would have expected that the way Portugal have played so far. Simoes. Eusebio just moving ahead of him. And with the strength to get in the cross, the goalkeeper's lost it. And Brazil have lost the goal. It's Simoes. Well, the holders are now in serious danger of going out in the group stage. Simoes, after great work by Eusebio. Coluna is there, but he walks away. Eusebio has earned the right to take charge at all free kicks for Portugal. Oh, and it was desperately close. And he knew it. Well, there's only Torres to aim for, and Coluna does just that. Torres has won it. Eusebio! This is incredible. Brazil are two down. And they fell really for a sucker punch then. They just didn't know how to handle Torres, although they must have realised the ball would come towards him. The first header was from Torres, the scoring header from Eusebio. With a two-goal lead, Portugal playing with wonderful confidence now. And on goes Eusebio again. The shot didn't match the run, which was superb. Simoes. Still Simoes. Eusebio taking on from him. Well, it could have bounced Portugal's way off Manga. They just cannot stop him, and the measure of Eusebio's confidence. A shot from what, 45 yards? Brazil have got to try and force the pace now. This is Rildo, and he's found the bottom corner. Brazil have bounced back with a goal which had quality in it, but also force of numbers as well. Rildo coming from deep. And that's much more authentic from Brazil, 2-1. Portugal trying to play to their strengths, which obviously Eusebio, but really their attack generally. He's simply irresistible, and he wants to be involved everywhere. The short corner. Torres, a nuisance again. Eusebio! Well, whenever you think
You've seen everything in his repertoire. He comes up with something even better. A whipped volley here that sped into the net.
So, Portugal beat the reigning World Cup champions in style. Eusebio becomes the new star of the World Cup. In the quarterfinals, Portugal are drawn against the unknown and unfancied North Koreans. It turns out to be an amazing game. It starts with the Koreans racing into a 3-0 lead.
Maybe surprise. Yes, in 22 minutes, a surprise, 3-0 for Korea. And now, you know, the game is the 90 minutes and 24 and a half. I scored the first goal. And I scored in the second, the penalty kick, and 3-2 in 45 minutes. And our second time, I come fulfilled, for fight for win the game. And now I scored another 2 goals, and I scored 4 goals in the game against Korea.
Well, we're two very popular teams here. Portugal have done so much, but North Korea with that wonderful win over Italy. And this is a promising start from them. Oh, it's gone! I don't believe it! Oh, and met by Eusebio with the full force, but not the accuracy. The goalkeeper's in trouble. Pulled back by Cook and turned in by Wu. It's 2-0. Good work by Cook. Now Ick, who scored the goal against Italy. It'll run back for Cook again, surely not three. It is! Simply incredible! Jose Augusto. North Korea retreating. Oh, and Eusebio got the better of them. That's one back, and he wants to get the game restarted. Torres. And Torres tripped in the act of shooting. A penalty, no doubt about it. This 4-3-2, Eusebio makes the most of it. Well, enough incident to fill an entire World Cup in this game, and Eusebio has a hat-trick. Well, North Korea labouring now, and Eusebio so full of running. It's a fabulous comeback, this, by Portugal. And they've now got the chance to take the lead for the first time. A second penalty. And Eusebio, it's been a solo performance. He's got 4 out of 4. Flipped over by Myung, who's done well, from Eusebio again. Torres. Oh, it's an open goal! And Jose Augusto, 5-3.
I played my best game in my life.
That was your best game in your life?
Yes, in my life, in the national team.
And then you moved on to the semi-final, one of the great World Cup games against the host nation, England. What do you remember about that fantastic night?
You know, against England, you know, England is a good team. They have good defender, good midfield, good striker. You know, I believe, you know, it's going to be a tough game because England is England, you know. You play in Wembley. I believe when I talk with players, so England, he come to Liverpool, he play against us. Come to Manchester United play against Portugal, he beat England. But in Wembley, it's very difficult for us.
Wilson. Bobby Charlton making a run forward from midfield. Wilson looks beyond him and has picked out Roger Hunt. And Charlton followed in! England have scored! Bobby Charlton was on the spot. Ray Wilson hit it long. And Roger Hunt got the run on Carlos. But Charlton got to the loose ball and steered it in. Nicely guided down by Torres. What a great tournament he's had. So difficult to handle in the air. Jack Charlton was up well. It was Eusebio who hit it, and Banks had to make a terrific save, low to his right. Good jump by Torres. Eusebio's header. Banks in the right place again. Still 1-0 to England. Moore. For Cohen. Hurst making a run. But Cohen's rather overhit it, but Hurst using his strength. He's looking for Charlton, it's two! Bobby Charlton bangs in his second. And Jeff Hurst, who's kept Jimmy Greaves out of the side, shows his value by creating Charlton's second. Wide by Eusebio. Torres waiting for a cross now. And he's pulled away well. Banks has lost it. Handball, not by the goalkeeper, but by Jack Charlton. A penalty to Portugal that can put them back in contention. And England, who haven't conceded a goal so far in the tournament, are in danger, serious danger, of conceding one now. Here goes Eusebio against Banks, past Banks. 2-1.
Portugal's World Cup dream is over. For Eusebio, there's consolation in defeat. He collects £1,000 for finishing as the tournament's top scorer. His 9 goals also ensure him of a place among the all-time great goal scorers and earn this glowing tribute from England's World Cup winning captain, Bobby Moore.
Most players that you play against have certain strengths and certain weaknesses. I think, without a doubt, I mean, his strengths were very, very much in the power of his shooting and primarily in his right foot. I mean, he was quick and he was pacey and he was strong. But I think, you know, the problems that you had with Eusebio was that you knew full well that anywhere 30 yards from goal, he was going to start presenting problems to you, because he could unleash, you know, a powerful shot at goal from that distance and still be hitting target and still be hitting the back of the net. So you were very, very aware that you had to close him down very, very quickly. But yeah, I mean, he was a super player. He's a lovely, lovely person and, you know, one of the great goal scorers.
Eusebio.
Bobby Charlton's one of the most famous footballers ever to wear an England jersey. Capped 106 times by his country, Charlton was an important part of the 66 World Cup winning side. He'd been in the team that reached the quarterfinals in 1962. But it's in England, 4 years later, that Charlton and company make their mark under the management of Alf Ramsey.
Alf Ramsey came and instituted the 4-3-3 system, and then suddenly, going away from home, we found quite easy. You know, we had the pattern, we had the players to fit in quite easily. Everybody knew what the responsibilities were, and we started getting results away that we'd never had before. And it was fantastic. I thought, well, this will do me, you know. Playing at Wembley on our own pitch, and not a lot of teams had ever won at Wembley. I mean, only 2 or 3 teams, I think, had ever won at Wembley. And we were very familiar with it. I thought, well, no, we'll take some licking there. And I was pleased when Alf Ramsey got the job that he said, we'll win the World Cup in 1966. And I believed him, because I thought that we'd do that after 62.
England draw Uruguay, Mexico and France in their group. The opening match against Uruguay finishes in a disappointing goalless draw. Did Charlton believe the Mexico match would go the same way?
No, I didn't. I thought we would score a goal. I mean, somebody had to score a goal sooner or later. And I felt that the Mexicans were under a bit of a strain anyway. You know, they were having to fight really hard to keep us out. And I got a goal from a long way out, and we're pleased to, I was very pleased to see it go in, but I didn't doubt for a moment that we would still beat Mexico. I carried the ball from my own half, and I kept waiting to have to pass it to someone, but no one challenged me, and I kept going out further and further, nearer to the goals, and I thought, well, if I get another 5 or 10 yards here, I'm going to have a shot, because I just thought, well, I'm getting near the block. I roughly looked at the goals, and then I just concentrated on hitting it properly. And you look up then, and of course it could have gone straight to the goalkeeper, but it didn't, it went right in the corner.
Now Charlton, who turned the match so dramatically England's way. There's space here for Greaves, and a goal! Roger Hunt, 2-0 to England.
And Roger Hunt grabs two more against France. England win their group. Now they'd face more South American opposition in the quarter-finals.
We stayed at Wembley and played Argentina, who had been probably the most impressive with the Germans of all the other countries, and probably the team that I think that if we hadn't won the World Cup, that Argentina would have won it. I think that they were a very, very strong side. But they're very bad travellers and they're very bad on discipline. They get themselves in all sorts of trouble. And of course, with what happened with Ratten in the quarterfinals, when he was sent from the field for not leaving the referee alone, literally, and for not accepting the referee's decisions. Well, I mean, that was the worst thing that he could have done for his own side. But we didn't mind. We didn't mind once he'd done it. And it was a very tough match, even against the 10 men. But Jeff Hirst scored a goal and we progressed to the semis.
And Portugal, that really was a classic game.
Cracking game, that. Yeah. Cracking game, yeah. It was a night match, floodlight, and I always remember it was a lovely, crisp night. And one that any footballer loves to play in, because to breathe is easy when it's that kind of night, and the ball seems to move faster and everybody feels better. And both teams put on one of the games of the tournament, and it was super. And it was a tough game, but the ball fell nicely to us that day. Ball fell nicely. I was backing up a run by Roger Hunt, where Ray Wilson, I think, had sent the ball forward, and the goalkeeper came out frightened of Roger's challenge, and he kneed the ball straight back to me, straight into my path, and I just slid it into the empty goal. So. And the next one, Jeff Hirst had loads of time, picked the ball up, shrugged off this challenge, had looked up, you know, and then just popped it right in my path. And when you're steaming in it full out, it would have been a terrible miss if I hadn't scored that one. But there again, 2-0, and they got one back through a penalty from Eusebio, but we hung on, and we got to the final, which we all thought we would.
You were singled out by West Germany for special attention in the final with Franz Beckenbauer. Did you expect that?
I didn't really. I think there was a lot of publicity about me because I scored the two goals in the semi-final. And Helmut Schön had told Franz Beckenbauer, I didn't know, but he told Franz Beckenbauer that he had to stick with me all the time. And my responsibility was also to stick with Franz Beckenbauer. He was my patch. That was my patch. I had to pick him up. And between us, we hardly contributed anything at all to the game of any consequence, I don't think. But I was more prepared, I think, to forego my contribution. And I think I was less missed by my team than Franz Beckenbauer was by his.
England certainly haven't seized the initiative yet. Wilson with a difficult one to deal with. It's a stray header. Haller. Helmut Haller for West Germany. Charlton slipping Beckenbauer this time. That hasn't been easy to do. And Bobby Moore well forward as England pursue an equaliser. Foul by Overath. Moore's free kick. Quickly taken. Hurst is free. England are level. Quest, Hurst celebrates. Now Hurst. Trying to make room for a shot. Peters! 2-1! Can that win it for England? Charlton determined to make the ball his. conceded the free kick. This must be the last chance for West Germany, who scored first here at Wembley, but now trail by 2-1. With the 90 minutes very nearly up. And just time for this free kick to be taken. Emmerich has paced out his run. And England can't clear it. Faber! A sensational equaliser for West Germany. In the nick of time for them. Charlton, off the post. Ball breaking to the right. And well picked out by Nobby Stiles. First coming towards the near post. Her shot. And Hunt, who might have followed it in, has appealed for a goal. England collectively turn and look at the linesman. And what has happened here? A 2-2 in extra time, and the Russian linesman backed them off. Has told the referee that he believed the ball crossed the line. And her shot, the Germans are livid. And England happy to get the ball into West Germany's half. And Hurst might do more than that. He's got a hat-trick, and England have won the World Cup.
I mean, I said to our jacket at the end of it all, when we were on the pitch and everybody, the crowd, and get very emotional over these things. I said, well, if ever you say to anybody, we are the best, they can never argue with you now because you've proved it. There's nothing more that you can do in the game but winning the top football trophy, and we've done it. And I thought when we were doing our lap of honour and going up to receive the trophy from the Queen and everything else, I thought, well, that's really the rest of your life sorted out, you know. I wonder if it'll ever be equaled. Even if it was equaled, I don't think that it would be maybe the same as with the players that we actually had at that time. There was a tremendous affection for all the players. And it just was right that we should win it.
4 years on, and England defend the World Cup in Mexico. Their opponents include the favourites Brazil, Romania and Czechoslovakia.
It's always going to be difficult trying to defend a title, but we had as good, if not in some cases, better players than we had in 1966. People thought that. I thought that 1966 was the best. But nevertheless, we had good players. People had come in like Francis Lee, Tommy Wright, Terry Cooper. This majority of them were still there. Gordon Banks, Bobby Moore, Alan Ball, Martin Peters, Jeff Hurst, etc. But we did actually fancy, because the results had still kept going. We'd still kept playing well and winning. And we still thought that we would do quite well there.
Waiting for Alan Ball to take over. Peter's running well. Lee. Chance for Hurst. Hurst! There it is! Jeff Hurst! Jeff Hurst has made it. 1-0.
A victory over Romania. Then England lose to Brazil. But in the last group match, a 1-0 win over the Czechs puts them into the quarterfinals. Now, another epic World Cup match against West Germany. As Charlton prepares for the kickoff, he knows England's cause has been weakened by Gordon Banks' late withdrawal because of illness. In goal, England have Peter Bonetti for only the seventh international of his career. Despite Charlton's fears, England get off to a great start.
Again, Murray not being given a specific marking job at the moment. Way over the far side is Keith Newton, and it's a good ball for him. Newton should take his pass over us now, run at him. Through ball for Murray! Alan Murray! Alan Murray! Newton is overlapping like blazes down the right side, being chased all the way back there by Law. Good cross ball, and the far side is hurt! And it's to the left! Step up! Martin Peters called it wrong. Pistol. Oh, and Moore stopped that one in the stomach and it hurt. Over on. Beckenbauer. Moore still down injured. Beckenbauer.
in the net. Beckenbauer scores. So that cuts it back a bit.
Kaiser's lead was laid out. And Bobby Charlton is going off in this hold-up.
I knew I was coming off because, and of course, I was one of the older players, and it was quite normal for me to be substituted. But I don't think anybody really expected to, you know, the catastrophe really that followed when I was brought off. Because Beckenbauer scored while I was on the field, and he went away, and the ball went under Peter Benetti, and then I came off, and it's the worst time I've ever had watching football match, because you could just sense that it was all drifting away from us, and little Muller, the centre forward, and Uwe Seeler, two of the littlest forwards, the smallest forwards you could ever wish for, got two goals. Uwe Seeler with a quite phenomenal goal, which you don't know whether he went for goal or just went to put it into the general area, but it went in the back of the net, so 2-2 and into extra time, and they got the third goal in extra time to beat us. And England had never had three goals scored against them for years. So it was a catastrophe, and of course everybody said it was because Alf brought me off. I'm not being disrespectful to Peter Benetti, but I would more rather say that it was because Gordon Banks went down that day with the only illness, tummy illness that we had in the whole of the trip, on the only day when we had our first sudden death match. And it was unbelievable coincidence that. And it just would appear to have been fate. Because I'm not being disrespectful again, like I say to Peter Benetti, but Gordon Banks was streets ahead of any other goalkeeper in the world. He was almost unbeatable there. And to lose him was much more of a catastrophe than me being substituted. And it was the 106th game, and I'd said to the lads that we would have a couple of glasses of champagne to celebrate me 106, which was the England's record. And really, I was quite glad in a way, because it was more of an excuse to have a drink after, to get it out of the system. But nobody thought about anything to do with me. It was just the whole disaster of losing, because we would have loved to have won the World Cup abroad. And we were a good team, we were a great team, and that would have just sort of put the icing on the cake if we could have done that. It's one regret I've always had, that we never actually won the World Cup outside of Rocky.
Diego Maradona is recognised as the greatest footballer in the world today. His sensational performances in the 1986 finals ensured his place amongst the legends of the game and won the cup for Argentina. With this success has followed the unrelenting attention of football fans and the media worldwide. Maradona now treads an uneasy path through life at the top. His genius, though, has shone through from the very early days.
Keep moving up, don't you ever stop. Whatever it is, take it to the top. Keep moving up, don't you ever stop. Whatever it is, take it to the top.
The world's out there waiting, and it's yours for the taking. So come on, get up. It's time to go. Stop hesitating and anticipating to the top. That's your mark. Get ready, set, go. So let's go, take it to the top. Don't stop, 'cause we'll be moving, yeah. You can make it to the top. Don't stop, we'll be grooving.
Maradona! Hey! Go!
Maradona's first appearance in the World Cup was in 1982 in Spain, when his talent was still blossoming.
He begins to show flashes of the style that would set him above the rest, although at this stage, the 21-year-old is unable to escape the attentions of some of the world's toughest defenders. Italy's Gentile singles out Maradona for some special attention, but even he can't completely stifle the talent.
Maradona, oh, so unlucky. No wonder he holds his head in his hands. That's the second time in this World Cup he's struck the woodwork. And really, he was so unlucky there, Diego Maradona.
Flashes of brilliance, flashes of a volatile temperament, but no shortage of admirers, including the man who would lift the World Cup in 1982, Italy's Dino Zoff.
Effettivamente è stato nell'82 e direi che mi ha subito impressionato perché anche lui è un fuoriclasse.
Unfortunately, Maradona's first World Cup ends in controversy. Provoked to the limit by the Brazilians, Maradona's fuse finally blows and this regrettable challenge ends in a predictable red card. The long walk to the dressing room is one of despair. But Maradona remains in Spain after the finals, joining Barcelona for a then world record fee of £4.2 million. He moves on to Napoli in 1984, the fee an astonishing £6.9 million. And by 1986, now captain of his country, he's at the peak of his powers, both mentally and physically.
The free kick that Maradona has won, he takes, and he's now found Valdano, who finds the far corner. Argentina ahead, 5 minutes gone. Jorge Valdano. It's left for Maradona again, no surprise in that, and Rogeli! Two free kicks. Two goals, and South Korea on the rack. Maradona. Valdano with the simplest of goals.
Argentina next faced the Italians, and the world is treated to the full range of Maradona's skills. Here, blinding acceleration and superb control. Here, a defense-splitting pass. Here, amazing trickery to set up a chance at goal. And here, finding the net with the subtlest of touches. Next, it's Bulgaria who feel the power in his running, although this time the finish doesn't match the approach work.
Maradona is making a charge down the left touchline, and he's skipped round Yeliaskov beautifully. And if he can get a good cross in here, there must surely be a second goal! Burruchaga scores for Argentina!
Next, it's Uruguay, another win. Pedro Pasculi's goal decides the game. Maradona this time left frustrated by the referee's whistle as this legitimate-looking goal is ruled out. But as the tournament progresses and the games get harder, Maradona just gets better and better. From Puebla, Argentina move on to Mexico City, and Maradona is on the rampage.
Maradona picks a way through where there seemed to be none. And Shelton is back to it. It's Maradona's goal. And England claimed that it was put in with the hand. But we haven't been able to control the play in midfield the way that Maradona has been able to do. And he's hurting England again here. It's a brilliant run. It's one of the World Cup great goals. And there's no doubt about that one.
Now he's public property. The eyes of the world are constantly on him. Even on the training pitch, there's no escape from the cameras. Belgium are next to see him at very close quarters in the semi-finals.
Shaga.
Maradona lurking just around the edge of the area, and he's got into it, and he's scored! And once again, Diego Maradona has showed what a magnificent player he is. Just around the edge of the area, a sudden burst of speed. You see him going through, a flick of the left foot. We have flown to Belgium. We've been playing down their chances of winning here, as they have done in the two previous rounds. Gerrit, the defender, measured their chances in this one against Maradona as 1 in 10. And here's Maradona now. Is this number two? Oh, brilliant. Tremendous goal. Weaving past defenders, such strength and persistence. And what a cool finish too.
Some observers feel that Argentina without Maradona would be an ordinary side. But their fans will not worry about that. He's got them through to the World Cup final. Their opponents, West Germany. A worldwide audience of 580 million people in 160 countries, all watching to see if Maradona can turn it on again.
A lot of cheerers there. Maradona, the big man's in there too. Floated to the far side. Maradona, simple little touch, but a good one to Enrique. And now Maldana, and this could be the break again for Argentina, and he scored! 2-0! So Bremer with the corner for West Germany. And forced in by Rummenigge! Corner coming in, and he's there! Voila! 2-2! Now, Maradona, a touch by him, but Bonachaga's onside! Played onside by Beagle! And there's the reprieve for Argentina! Bonachaga makes it 3-2! A triumph for Diego Maradona.
The way he played, 86, it's this class comes very close to Pele. I never saw movements or tricks or understanding like he showed in the World Cup 86.
It was only the fact that Maradona produced a couple of flashes of brilliance in most games without doing a great deal in the games, but he always produces it in little flashes that are brilliance, and he won the World Cup for him. I mean, he was the difference between them being a very average side and being a great side.
But in 1990, the powers are waning. Maradona goes into the finals with long-term injury problems and a spell in a health clinic to lose weight. The champions start disastrously against the unfancied Africans from Cameroon.
It's in there! They've scored! Cameroon!
Next, it's the Soviet Union. Argentina overcome the loss of goalkeeper Pumpido, carried off with a broken leg, to get back to winning ways, 2-0.
Marty Kachaya showing good skill himself. And that's a dangerous-looking ball. Tronio! Yes!
Next, a scrappy 1-1 draw with Romania, and they stumble through to the second round. The goal from Monzon. Maradona's prayers are being answered. But now in the sudden death phase, they face Brazil, winners of all their first round games. Surely the crown will be plucked from Maradona's head.
And there's lots of support, Branco moving swiftly down the left. All it needed was a good cross. Oh! How did they get away with that? Careca takes on Monzon. That's a dangerous ball, it hit the bar. The keeper misjudged it. It was a brilliant ball. Now Alemão, good effort, oh, again, against the woodwork. But Alemão so unlucky, and so too were Brazil. Maradona for Argentina. Good run by Maradona, and still he goes on. And Caniggia could score here. Argentina 1-0.
Against all the odds, Argentina go on. Next, it's Yugoslavia in the quarterfinals and a penalty shootout after a goalless game. Maradona, unbelievably, misses his penalty kick. But the Yugoslavs are even more reckless. Here's Hadži Begic.
And it's simple enough now. If he scores, we go to sudden death. If he misses, Argentina will go through. Hadži Begic. And he saved it! And Goycochea takes Argentina into the semi-finals. And Argentina's luck holds good.
A semi-final in Maradona's adopted hometown, Naples, against host nation Italy. They fall behind to a goal from Italy's golden boy, Toto Schillaci. But once more, as their grip on the World Cup is slipping, Maradona finds a spark of invention.
Maradona. Good play again. Alarte Cachea on the left. Flipped in towards Caniggia! Caniggia has equalised!
So the semi-final will be decided on penalties. Maradona gets it right this time. But can Italy's Aldo Serena?
He has to score this. He's missed it! Argentina, the world champions, are through to the World Cup final again!
The final in Rome's Olympic Stadium is a poor advertisement for the game. It's marred by time-wasting from the Argentinians and overreacting by the Germans. Pedro Monzon is the first man ever to be sent off in a World Cup final. Argentina are beaten by Andy Bremer's late penalty. Diego Maradona bows out of World Cup football in tears, clutching at the memories that once made him the most feared player in the world.
Diego Maradona. Well, next up on the Hall of Fame is Pele.
Football has never had a better ambassador than Pele, the greatest player of his time, many would argue of all time. He's still as popular around the world today as he was when he masterminded Brazil to those tremendous World Cup triumphs.
Pele is running. It's Pele. Pele now! Yes, there it is! That is the touch of a master! Pele! Pele throwing it out. Pele, quite through the wall. How about that one then? Pele. And Pele in a good position here. He's absolutely through. Off the post. Portugal. Pele sneaking away. There's a beautiful pass for him. He's round the goalkeeper. Just let him run off. And he's gone. No! Magnificent dummy.
Without a doubt, Pele was the most complete player that I've ever come up against, and I think that was backed up by the Brazilian team manager in 1970 when we was in Mexico, and I had the good fortune of spending some time with him, being able to speak to him about Brazilian tactics. And obviously Pele came up, we're talking about the individual, and he was saying that basically if I wanted to pick him at right back, he would be my best right back. If I wanted to pick him at outside left, he could be my best outside left. Even if I wanted to pick him in goal, he said basically he could be nearly the best goalkeeper in Brazil. That was his talent. I mean, I don't think he had a weakness.
For all the natural football talent nurtured in Brazil, this football-crazy country hasn't won the World Cup as the team leaves behind the Rio beaches for success at last in Sweden in 1958. Pele is an unknown at the start of the competition. By the end of it, he's a 17-year-old superstar. He puts behind him a knee injury which has threatened his World Cup place. In the semi-final, his contribution is sensational, this hat-trick against France. The very name Pelé is made for the headlines, a nickname for Edson Arantes do Nascimento. He's the son of a professional player. He's coached at school by a World Cup squad member from 1934. He was born and bred for a job he does completely naturally. And he shows that again in the final against Sweden.
Always someone backing up Milton Santos this time.
Pele. And number three. Orlando. Pele. Matsu. Zagallo. Into Pele. And he scored in the very last minute.
Brazil victorious by 5-2, winning not just the World Cup, but millions of friends with their skill and sportsmanship, summed up by carrying the Swedish flag on their lap of honor.
First World Cup, to me, you know, I can tell you, was everything, because from there I start for the world.
4 years later, Pelé spearheads Brazil's attempt to retain the World Cup against wiser defenders this time.
Djalma Santos. Pele. Again, the three men that have attended to Pele throughout the game there. And a chance here for Pele, though, the ball run loose. To Zagallo, must score. And there it is, the first goal. Pele's fantastic speed took it through the defence there. Oh, and a great goal!
But Pele is injured in Brazil's second match and plays no further part. Even without him, Brazil are still victorious, but the competition lacks the sparkle Pele would have brought. Disappointment also awaits in the 1966 finals. Portugal pick him out for savage attention. With Pele in perpetual pain, Brazil are eliminated at the group stage. Pelé's popularity blossoms, partly because of his impeccable behaviour in the face of brutal attempts to prevent him playing. With Brazil and his club Santos, he tours the world. Always the reception is rapturous. The king of football mixes with royalty. Landmarks are logged too, like this 1,000th goal. Every football lover celebrates with those who see his achievements at closer quarters.
Pele, I mean, he's the best player, most spectacular player in the history of this game. He's the number one in the history of this game. Also, as a person, I like him very much. And we became really very, very close friends. And I really love him.
In 1970, Brazil are bidding to win the World Cup for the third time in 12 years. The setting is Mexico. The football is memorable. And after the disappointments of 1962 and 1966, Pele, by now 29 years old, is set for the very pinnacle of his career.
Not only myself, all the Brazil, no? All my country. Because Brazil, you know, win the World Cup, and that was the third time. You know, Brazil win the Julien Rimet definitively. I think this is a beautiful and the biggest memory in my life, and for Brazil also.
Pele, Rivellino, what a goal! What a goal! Rivellino! Gerson, as Pele is running, is Pele, Pele, no! Yes, there it is! That's the touch of a master! Jardino ran well, and he's onside! He must get him here now! Yes, indeed! Tremendous! Roar from the Czechs to back then to swear that Jardino was offside, but he ran well for that. It's 3-1, and those flags indicate what the Brazilians here think about that. Pelé, Pacheco inside, and way across the far side of Jardino. Jardino trying, may have to go all on his own. There's nobody up in support. Could go all on his own here. Building it up, there's the shot, and he scores! How about that, my man? Jardino dancing around the far side of the field, taking it foul.
Paulo Cesar, Brazilian, picking up the pace now, putting some pressure, real hard pressure. Harvesting the defense, the sail. And here's Pelé. Jardino, there it is. Jardino gets it. And the crowd
of the stadium erupts with excitement as Hansina goes up dancing around the stadium.
Blue shirt and white shorts to Romania. Tadeo Pele. Right through the wall. How about that one then? Pele. Everaldo. Back for Piazza Wilson, all the way back. For Fontana. Here goes Herzino. What's his left foot? Paulo Cesar. In behind them. Oh, there it is. No trouble about that one. Herzino it is. Herzino keeping his goal of game record going. Scored against Czechoslovakia twice against England. Now he's got the second goal for Brazil here. Is Herzino. Oh, and Tosteo in. Now Pele. Oh, yes. With the stolen in boot, Pele puts that one in there. This is the sign of a very great club, and put as much as you can through the ball.
Pele. Tosteo on his own in the centre. And a bad mistake by Campos. 11 is Rivellino. To Rivellino, the scorer. Tostao again, lovely little chip from Rivellino, and it's in! Completely deceived the goalkeeper, who was expecting a cross, and Tostao just flicked it behind him. 2-0, 15 minutes gone.
Number 11 is Rivellino. Pele. Nobody within 5 yards of him when he trapped that. 7 is Giacino. Pele moving outside him. Onside, Pele coming through. Beautiful push across the middle. Giacino, number 7. 11 is Rivellino. Paulo Cesar is out on the wing, but Giacino sprinting on. Round the goalkeeper. He's putting it in. What a goal! What a goal! Giacino!
Now into injury time in this first half. We play 15 seconds over the 45 minutes. Tostao. Clodoaldo going into the middle for the return, and there it is! What a goal! What a goal! Clodoaldo!
Giacino, Pele, Tostao. Nice little touch off there from Pele. Giacino, and he's round Matosas. What will Matosas do here? He scores! Yes! Gino down, thrusting himself, his colleague hugging him, Brazil 2, Uruguay 1. Carlos Alberto trying to bring a bit of calm, trying to control the ball. 20 seconds left on my watch. Tostao to Pele. Giacino away down the right. This time Pele knows he's there, but he might have a go himself. Trying to get it on his right foot, setting it up. And there it is, Giacino, Rivellino the scorer, 3-1. The game absolutely sewn up. Rivellino! Everybody on the field now, trainers, reserves.
Rivellino, watch Pele now. What a beautiful goal from Pele. El Rey Pele. 100 goals for Brazil in World Cup competitions, and Brazil take this 1-0 lead.
Clodoaldo is going over to join him. But Gerson is free in the middle. That's a good ball to set the left side going now. Everaldo. Herzino. Herzino, faced by Facchetti. Here goes Gerson. That's a good shot! What a beautiful goal by Gerson! Again a free kick then. Gerson aiming into the box for Pele, and he's in behind everybody. A chance now for Herzino. And he's walked it into the net. Giacino keeps his goal of game record going. It's 3-1 Brazil. And you have never seen a happier fella then than Giacino. Giacino. Faced by Facchetti. Oh, it's not a bad ball for Pele on the right side. It's Carlos Alberto. And what a great goal that was! Carlos Alberto
puts this game surely well beyond the reach of almost any side now. 4-1 with 3.5 minutes of the game left. Carlos Alberto scores his first goal of the competition. There it is then, the moment that the stadium has waited for, that the world has waited for, that certainly Brazil have waited for, that Carlos Alberto has waited for. The Jules Rimet Trophy, solid goals. Victory carrying an upraised cup is the design of the trophy. Victory then is the design of Brazil.
When people ask me who I think is the best player in the world, I would say Pele, because I think he is the most complete player.
His instinct was so great, you know, he was a perfect player.
In my whole life, 22 years, you know, as a professional, I think I have a luck. I have to say thanks, God.
Dino Zoff's international career started in 1968. It spanned 15 years and 112 appearances, including captaining Italy to a World Cup final victory in 1982. Zoff also achieved European success with Juventus as a coach, but his World Cup involvement started in 1970 when he was a substitute for the final. How frustrating was it for him to watch from the sidelines?
Ma è stata un'esperienza interessante perché ero abbastanza arrabbiato, ecco, però logicamente sapevo di aver davanti anche un portiere Albertosi che dava ampie garanzie, è stato un grande portiere anche Albertosi.
So Albertosi keeps him out of the side and Zoff witnesses a tremendous Brazilian performance.
Ma io ho sofferto anch'io e certamente la partita col Brasile non c'è stata molta storia, noi avevamo già dato il massimo e quindi contro quel Brasile, perché per la prima volta è stato un Brasile molto, molto forte atleticamente, oltre alla proverbiale classe e tecnica che hanno posseduto tutti i brasiliani, ma già da quel mondiale lì i brasiliani erano anche sotto l'aspetto atletico molto forti.
Here's Dino, faced by Facchetti. Oh, it's not a bad ball for Pele on the right side. It's Carlos Alberto. And what a great goal that was!
So, a loser's medal for Dino Zoff and the Italian team. But in 1974, Zoff establishes himself as the number one goalkeeper. And before that World Cup, he'd set a record of over 1,000 minutes without conceding a goal.
Ma è stato il periodo dal 72 al 74, prima di presentarci ai mondiali di Germania del 74. È stato un momento molto favorevole, noi avevamo una squadra molto forte, robusta, certamente non è solo merito mio, ma bensì di tutta la squadra e della difesa in particolare. Pressione non ce n'era molta e quindi io non ho mai patito i record, insomma li accettavo così come coronamento del personaggio, ma non mi hanno mai pesato molto.
Well, now the sequence is broken. It's Haiti who managed to beat Dino Zoff, but he's arrived on the world stage.
And Ayala's got a little bit of space, he can hit it. Oh, he did hit it! What a cracking try from Ayala! And the response of Dino Zoff with the save, showing why he is one of the greatest goalkeepers in the world. Look at that one, Joe! Fabulous save from Dino Zoff. Dania, moving fast, that's one of the longest throws we've seen. It's on for him! Good save! Oh, tremendous goalkeeping by Dino Zoff. Showed real class then, the lad.
Well, despite those heroics, Poland put Italy out of the World Cup in the first phase. And that must have been a tremendous disappointment to Dino Zoff, especially after seeing Italy go all the way to the final in Mexico.
Ma noi, come dicevo prima, il grosso problema quasi sempre per la nazionale italiana è superare il primo turno. Perché ci crea molte responsabilità e quindi la squadra gioca sempre molto contratta. E poi devo dire che quel mondiale è stato organizzato dirigenzialmente non molto bene. Erano troppa gente a comandare.
So now on to Argentina and 1978 and the wonderful ticker tape atmosphere of Buenos Aires. Italy are drawn in the same opening group as the hosts, Argentina. They play each other in the final game of the group after both teams had won their early games against France and the Hungarians.
La rarità, ecco, diciamo che in Argentina abbiamo cominciato bene, siamo andati bene quasi fino alla fine. Direi che la squadra si è espressa al meglio, ha fatto vedere un gioco veramente, veramente eccezionale. Forse è stata la prima volta nel mondo che abbiamo fatto capire alla gente che non eravamo solo dei catenacciari, ma bensì abbiamo giocato a tutto campo facendo un gioco forse il migliore di tutti quei mondiali.
More of these free kicks coming in on Dino Zoff's goal. Bonetti doing a bit of anxious organising this time, although this one is all of 30 yards out. And a great save by Zoff from Kempers, who is so angry. He thought he'd got it that time. Over the top, bending more than I think we've seen any free kick bend so far.
But he'll not beat Dino Zoff with a shot like that from that distance. He knows all about them, and he was already on his way well before the kick was taken.
Well, 10 years of international experience behind Dino Zoff. And now Bertoni with the resulting four. And a good header with Zoff again saved. This time from Passarella. Rossi still battling. Bettiger in the middle. Antonioni. Bettiger, Rossi and Bettiger going in on the 1-2. That's a goal!
So, Italy inflict the only defeat on Argentina in the year the hosts win the tournament. They then draw with West Germany and beat Austria with this typically opportunist goal from Paolo Rossi. So, did Zoff now believe they have a good chance of winning the tournament?
Ma sì, indubbiamente eravamo convinti perché la squadra si esprimeva molto bene, quindi avevamo dimostrato fin lì di essere molto forti, ecco, perché nessuna squadra ci aveva creato particolari difficoltà.
First though, they have to beat Holland to decide who goes through to the final. Both teams are on 3 points, and so, dramatically, in the last game of the group, the winners will go through to the World Cup final.
Cabrini turning it back for Bettiger, on for Benetti, and on goes Bettiger! Hard and low into the box. Rossi. Back in again. Gentile up. Crowd is up. That's a great goal! 15 minutes left now. 15 minutes between Holland and another World Cup final. One distance shot.
That goal put Italy out of the World Cup, and Holland went on to meet Argentina in the final. The Italian press were very critical of Dino Zoff for letting in those long-range efforts. So, does he feel he had a bad game?
No, io non ho fatto delle brutte partite. Direi che in fondo mi sono difeso anche abbastanza bene con l'Olanda, solamente ho preso un gol da Dian da molto lontano, questo sì, un tiro potentissimo, molto irregolare, che ha avuto una traiettoria strana e da lì veramente c'è stato così molte accuse, effettivamente magari potevo fare qualcosa di più, ma succede.
So, how fierce were the Italian critics? Did the supporters feel Zoff was responsible for the defeat?
Ma da noi è una critica molto, molto, molto forte, il calcio è molto seguito, quindi coi portieri in modo particolare la critica è molto severa, severissima, quindi io ho accettato queste critiche sapendo di non essere colpevole come mi davano del colpevole, però nello stesso tempo certamente una miglior prestazione mia, come dicevo prima, poteva portarci alla finale.
So now on to 1982, and Spain are the hosts. Dino Zoff is now captain of Italy. The criticism of 78 is behind him. He's recognised as one of the best goalkeepers in the world. Although, as usual, Italy are off to a bad start in the first phase. They draw against Poland, Peru, and even manage to concede this goal to Cameroon. So did Zoff feel they'd improve dramatically in the next stage?
Ma noi avevamo fiducia nelle nostre possibilità perché eravamo una buona squadra, una squadra molto affiatata, era un buon gruppo di giocatori molto uniti e quindi avevamo fiducia nei nostri mezzi e perciò abbiamo così accettato le critiche abbastanza normalmente.
Well, in the second phase, Italy are drawn in an incredibly strong group. In the first game, though, against Argentina, Zoff and Italy show they're a major force this time round.
There is Maradona showing us some of those skills, and now Diaz showing some of his own. Comes back to Maradona. Surrounded by blue shirts, and what a fine effort that was by Diaz. Oh, that was a cracker.
And a marvellous save by Dino Zoff.
Conte, Tardelli streaking ahead of him. Antonioni's down the far side. He's onside too. Antonioni trying to tease up for Tardelli. 1-0 to Italy. Champions in a bit of bother. They might not be now. Oh, what a save from Zoff. That was a magnificent save from Dino Zoff. We've got the ball away to Graziani. Oh, fine ball through. Rossi's onside. He could clinch it here. Paolo Rossi. Oh, he couldn't make it, but Filio gets it away. There's still nobody back there. Right there. That is it. It's all over now, surely. Cabrini has made it 2-0.
Ma il Brasile sono ricordi eccezionali perché prima di tutto la critica dava molto favorito il Brasile perché effettivamente aveva una squadra che giocava molto bene, una grande squadra e quindi per noi è stato uno scontro veramente importante. Noi eravamo convinti di poter battere il Brasile. E la difficoltà era che loro gli bastava il pareggio, quindi noi dovevamo assolutamente vincere, però non era nelle nostre possibilità perché la nazionale italiana dell'82 era una squadra efficace, pericolosa, veloce e quindi anche se il Brasile era una grandissima squadra che teneva molto bene la palla, giocava molto, però io sono convinto che su 10 partite quell'Italia contro quel Brasile ne avrebbe vinte 7 sicure.
Still they come forward with Conte, who plays a very good ball for Cabrini. Useful looking cross. It's 1-0 Italy. Rossi. Oh, it's been given away. Here's Rossi. Oh, it could be a calamitous mistake. Oh, that really a dreadful mistake by the Brazilian defence. Corner taken by Conte, a long and a high one. And the shot from Tardelli. Rossi's got a hat-trick. Now it's the Italians' turn to come off the bench. Brazil thought they'd got it sewn up. Paolo Rossi's got a hat-trick.
A magnificent victory over Brazil. The favourites are beaten. Italy also beat Poland in the semi-final, 2-0, both goals from Paolo Rossi. And now it's West Germany in the final.
In from Gentile, a goal! Rossi's turned away, climbing it. Now Rossi, if anyone deserves a shot, it's him. But Scherer, Bergami, they've almost had too much time until it comes to Tardelli. And they've picked their moment. Marco Tardelli expressing what it's like to score in a World Cup final.
So, Dino Zoff lifts the World Cup, the climax of a magnificent career. Dino Zoff deserves his place in the World Cup Hall of Fame.
Our last Hall of Fame goes back to the World Cup finals of 1974.
Knocks it again for Kroll. Cruyff is in the middle, and he's there! What a beautiful goal, 2-0. Johan Cruyff, the master.
Johan Cruyff was indeed the master of the great Dutch team of the early 70s. At that time, Holland had some of the most gifted individuals ever to grace a World Cup stage. Their unique style of play became known as total football.
Well, I think we had a lot of stars in the team, and the discipline in the team was so high that anyone who had a very good day could use his individual qualities, and everybody surrounded him supported him. So anywhere, anyone who had some more than the other one, because before the game you never know who would be the best one. That's why it's the nicer thing that you couldn't say before who were the best player that day.
This was a lineup to treasure. The faces became familiar names in 1974. Rensenbrink, Rep, Naiskins, Kroll and Van Hanegem, all lieutenants to Cruyff's general.
Well, basically it comes because the heart of the team was from Ajax, who were playing together a long time. Second, the quality of players who went with the team was so good. They had so many intelligent, like Van Hanegem, like Janssen. They could fit together. And you could see that for instance, the sweeper was Hahn. Even we had better sweepers. That we wanted to have the ball, we wanted to play the ball, so we put a midfield player in the back. All through, he was not a good defender. But we had the ball and we could start playing, you could say. And if we would have another type of player, you would have a missing link. And that was the problem, let's say, a month before we went into the World Championships, that at that stage we didn't have even a team. I mean, the team was made, let's say, a week before the champions started. Then, on a certain moment, a brainwave from the coach probably, where he saw pieces come together.
It's a style of play developed by coach Rinus Michels that enables Holland to win their group with ease in the 74 finals. Waiting for them in the next round, the reigning champions Brazil, plus Argentina and East Germany. The Dutch total football proves too much for the South Americans.
Touch again for Wolf. Gazzaldi in the back from Rensenbrink, but no foul given. Very extraordinary. Rensenbrink then for Van Hanegem. Cruyff, but he's all right. He's all right for number one. Johan Cruyff. 1-0 Holland. I wonder how far we'll go back. It's a happy Dutch bench at this moment. 1-0 Holland, about 10 minutes of the game gone. That ball through for Cruyff. He looked rationally offside, but he did everything right afterwards. Wim Jansen to take the corner against Carnevale. Carnevale up. We got only a small touch. Kroll! That'll do. Oh, that was a whacker. Rudy Kroll scores his first goal of the competition. A really swinging fullback belt. 2-0 Holland. About 24 minutes and a half gone. See here exactly the power he puts into this. The goalkeeper didn't really get it away positively. And that bang was in the net before anybody could move. 2-0. For Cruyff again. Looking for Naiskins. What a beauty! Naiskins makes it 3-0. And the Dutch bench. Dr. Grotbrood is there. Reinus Mikkels is in there. Cheering and roaring. And that wraps it up surely now. 3-0. All coming from this great man, Cruyff. What a fine, fine piece of running from Naiskins on the far post. He really did well to get there. A difficult ball for the goal to keep it against, because he got over it and headed it down. And there's gloom and despondency on the bench.
First of all, before the World Championship started, we played against Argentina in Amsterdam. We won 4-1.
At the same time, we knew that Argentina was a very good team. They had some, a lot of players in the team who played in Europe, especially in Spain. Not everybody was already at the first game, so before the World Championship. They were in the team already, they had the preparation already. They came quite a little late. We knew, and that's one of the stronger things, I think, from the Dutch mentality too. When you have to do something together, we can do something together. Which means it was the first game of the second round, and we had to win. There was no question, because if we wouldn't win, you were out. So there was no way back. And I think the Dutch team, especially that time, and even in our character, when we have to prove to do something, we can.
Holland follow up that 4-0 win with another victory over East Germany. They lead the group table, along with Brazil, who also have maximum points. As they prepare to face each other, both sides know victory means a place in the final. Brazil are defending champions, so it's a mountainous task for Johan Cruyff and his country.
Well, first of all, not only you play against a team as Brazil, but you play against a legend, which is normal, which means a lot of things together. But at the other end, like I said already a few times, mentality is a very important thing, especially the Dutch one, which means that everything went so well. And then if you go against, like you said, a big mountain, everybody's together. And as soon as we're together, you basically can do anything you want. At that particular moment, we could say that football-wise, technical-wise, we were even better than the Brazils, which normally, through their legend, they're always technically very well, if you remember all the names who were in the teams before. And especially this team, I think they copied it a little, European football, which means long, more on physics, more on running. And now they face a team again who were beside the physical side, had technically wise a lot of baggage, a lot of discipline, team discipline. I think we were very confident to go into that game.
You weren't afraid of them at all?
No. We were very confident to go into that game.
Van Hanegem for Neeskens. Van Hanegem, that curveball, aiming for... Yes, he's there! And a shot, he's on for Cruyff! Oh, what a chance! Tremendous left-footed drive then from Johan Cruyff. As Di Maria got himself into all kinds of problems. Flying bodies around there as Jairzinho shields this ball beautifully. Janssen breaks away from Dessieu. Rensenbrink. They're only attacking with three men at the moment. It's Van Hanegem. Subir starts to run inside them. Beautiful running by the fullback. Point blank save from Leal. Subir. Van Hanegem on the jump, comes in for Rensenbrink, and that's a... Well, he really placed that one, took all the time in the world over it. Dessieu. Jairzinho fighting for it and losing. Neeskens. Cruyff. Neeskens gone on into the box again, going for it. And it's there! That might have been Neeskens, it might have been... Luis Pereira, but Neeskens is getting the credit for it. Beautiful return ball. Rinus Michels is up on his feet, sits down with that great big grin on his face, and the Dutchmen are going mad. Let's see if we can spot exactly now. There's the return ball coming from Cruyff, and watch the number two. No, that looks like Neeskens all right. No doubt about it. 1-0 Holland, Neeskens the scorer. Rensenbrink is forward. Knocks it again for Kroll. Cruyff is in the middle, and he's there. What a beautiful goal, 2-0. Johan Cruyff, the master. Superb break then. He must have been going at the speed of an Olympic sprinter when he just managed to get his right foot to that ball. It's 2-0 Holland.
The team of Brazil, which I saw in 74, for me was not a Brazilian team. If I see, for instance, the games in 78 or in 70s or any league game, they're different. And I think that was the biggest mistake they made.
Holland's superb win over Brazil puts them into the final for the first time in their history. They'd set the World Cup alight with their style of play. Now they face the host nation, West Germany, who are surely favourites on their home territory.
The quality of the German are, they are always very strong, physically very, very strong. They can run until tomorrow, you could say. And we were more technique, which means that the skills we had to survive. And when you get tired, it's normal that the technique goes down a little. That was one. Second thing was very unfortunately that at that particular game there were three players injured who we wanted to play, but were not 100% fit. And like you said, the Stoto football team at that time was a machine. And you know that if in a machine little things go wrong, there are big problems. And I think that's the basis reason why we lost that game. All through, if you see the whole game back, we missed a lot of chances, which would normally would go in. But then I say again, hey, if you analyze it well, maybe you're just one step late. So the opportunity is there, but not really there.
Well, Holland still had the ball, Cruyff going all the way on his own, brought down to the box, and Jeff Taylor points to the spot. Bernie Boat brought him down, that's the first time, and Johan Cruyff was on the ball. And unhesitatingly, Jack Taylor points to the spot. We're in the first minute of the game. There's Cruyff moving forward, there's his marker, and oh yes, indeed, there was no doubt about that one. Nation 1-0 Holland, and the ground erupts. That was very nearly the fastest goal ever scored in a World Cup final match. Holson by. Crowd, West Germans roaring him into the box. Holson going all the way on his own and fell most dramatically, and the penalty given. So two penalties in the game. This one for 1-1. He got it. And the ground erupts.
Good running by Bono.
Muller there to support him. Going on his own. Now Muller looks for it. Gets it. Oh, that's the way that little man gets them. That's the way he gets it.
Holland bearing it across.
And that is going to be a tremendous point-blank save from Naismith by Meyer. What a goalkeeper this fellow is turning out to be. He could, at the last second, just got his body in the way of it.
Call for Subir.
Cross in it, just wide. Oh, how did that go past? Unbelievable from Johnny Rep.
The four-goal top scorer of this side. See how close that was.
Naiskin, ready to whack it. Tremendous shot. Wide on the left side.
It was not a question of being beating at that time or losing world championship at that time. I don't think it just comes into your mind. It's just a question of that we went into the final, we were happy, and we were the best team. Even in that game, we were the best team. So it's more or less a disappointment. Afterwards, 3 or 4 weeks afterwards, you're going to realize, hey, you lost the world championship. It's only once in 4 years. So you see the dramatical situation, you see always afterwards. At that time, it was just a disappointment. Well, I'm very happy to be a member of the World Cup Hall of Fame.